Good morning. Welcome to Victorious Faith. I'm Cherri Campbell. I want to remind you again that this Saturday, November 18, is our next Victorious Faith service in North Denver in Thornton. And we're meeting again at the Holiday Inn Express and Suites on the northeast corner of 120th Avenue and Grant Street. And we're meeting at 6:30. So come and join us this Saturday, November 18 at 6:30 p.m. in North Denver, in Thornton, at the Holiday Inn Express and Suites on the northeast corner of 120th Avenue and Grant Street. For more information, you can go to my website at victoriousfaith.co. Victorious is like a champion, V-I-C-T-O-R-I-O-U-S, faith, F-A-I-T-H, .co, like Colorado. And go to the meeting schedule page. There you will see the details of the time and location. So come join us this Saturday, November 18 at 6:30 p.m. in Thornton at the Holiday Inn Express and Suites for our next service. You will be blessed and be glad you came. Glory to God. Now we are studying the lesson, Proofs That Abundance Is God's Will. Proofs That Abundance Is God's Will. And last week and yesterday, we were talking about the goodness of God. God is good. And we gave the definition for that. And we went over that for days. Yesterday, in the close of the program, I read you two scriptures that I want to read again in case you had to cut off the program early. These two last two scriptures are important. Psalm 27:13 says, I am still confident of this. Now, confident is a word that relates to faith. Confidence. I will see the goodness of the Lord. Where? In the land of the living. Now, yes, they're alive in heaven, but that's the place of eternity. The land of the living, when it's written in the Bible, it's the earth. And I am sure you can see that. And so what this psalmist is saying, I am confident, I believe, I have faith, I will see the goodness of the Lord, not just after I die and go to heaven. That would be, as in the Old Testament, in their thinking, that would be the land of the dead. After you die, yes, you still live on forever, but it's where the departed spirits go. We go to heaven. That's not what he's saying. I believe, I am confident, I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. The psalmist is saying, here, in this land, on earth, before I die, I will see the goodness of the Lord. The King James translation says it like this. I had fainted, or I would have fainted, unless I had believed. Well, there is the word believe. That's again connected to your faith. I would have fainted unless I had believed, had faith, to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Again, that's here and now, in this land, before I die. Now, that is important, because what is hopelessness? Hopelessness is not expecting to see good. Discouragement and people with negative outlooks, they are people who don't expect to see good. That's also called pessimism. There's a lot of Christians who are pessimists. A lot of Christians are pessimists. But do you know what? That is not obeying what the Bible says that we should believe. The Bible says that we should believe to see good. Believe to see good, or the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living, here and now, in this earth, before I die. I believe to see goodness. I believe to see the goodness of God. I believe to see good. You know, your faith and your hope go hand in hand. Hope is expectation, and it's specifically expectation for good. And biblical expectation is expecting God to do good and expecting God's promises to come to pass and be fulfilled in your life. And that is expectation, but your faith has to believe to see the good. And so it is so important that you add faith, use your faith to see the goodness of the Lord. You must believe it. You must say it. You must say things like, God is good to me, and good things are happening for me. And like I said, there's a lot of pessimistic Christians. If you're pessimistic, you are in unbelief. You do not believe to see the goodness of God, because pessimism believes to see bad. And you are playing right into the devil's hands when you believe to see bad, because your faith in believing bad things allows the devil the opportunity to bring bad. But your faith in God to do good for you is what allows God and releases the power of God. Faith is what activates the promises of God in your life. So you need to believe the promises of God and believe God will do what he says, and God is doing good for you. God is good to me. You have to make it personal. You see God being good to that person or that person and so, and then discouragement says, well, why isn't God good to me? You have to believe he is, because for one thing, he is. He always is. He doesn't do anything but good, but you must believe it. You must believe God is good to me, and good things are happening for me. Good things are happening for me. And if you keep your faith there in the goodness of God and in the promises of God, and that God will perform his promises in your life, you will always have expectation, or hope, I should say, which is expectation for good. Praise the Lord. And one more scripture, Psalm 23:6. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. That's here on earth. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So that's eternity. Here on earth, goodness and mercy follow me. And in eternity, I dwell in the house of the Lord. That's here and now, here and now and later. But you must believe again, surely. That is a sure thing. Absolutely, positively, surely, goodness is following me all the days of my life. You need to even believe that and say that. Goodness just follows me everywhere I go. Good things are happening to me every day. Goodness follows me all the days of my life. God is so good to me. God is good to me. Good things are happening for me. God, goodness follows me everywhere I go. Goodness is happening for me all day long. You need to believe it. You need to add your faith and believe God for the goodness of God happening in your life. According to Psalm 27:13, I am confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And Psalm 23:6, surely goodness and mercy follow me all the days of my life. Everywhere I go, every day, all day long, good things are happening for me. Goodness is just following me around. Goodness is overflowing in my life. God's goodness is overflowing in my life. Amen. So that is concluding proof number 16, the goodness of God. And I just wanted to give you those last two scriptures again, because I hurriedly gave them to you yesterday in the program. Now let's go on to proof number 17. Proof number 17 proves that abundance is God's will. It is the names of God, the names of God. Now, in the Bible, God is identified with different names. And each of his names identify part of his character or an attribute of his character and his nature, who he is, what he is, and what he does. Because what he does comes from who he is. So the names of God identify God's nature and character and his works, because what he does comes from his nature, who he is. Just like in the last point where we're saying God is good and what he does is good. Psalm 119:68. So because he is good, his works are good. Praise God. So the names of God, and we're going to look at two of the names of God revealed in scriptures. And the first name I want to mention, that I'm sure you've heard of both of these, but the first one is Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh. Probably, though, the Hebrew is actually pronounced Jireh. Jireh. But in America, people say Jireh. And you've probably heard Jehovah Jireh before. And the name Jehovah, first of all, let's break the name down. Jehovah, the first part of that name, it's a compound name, with the name Jehovah being many times in scriptures linked to another name that are compounded together that identify God. Jehovah means the eternal and the self-existent one, and the one who was and is to come. So it is more of a broad term, broad name. God is eternal. God is self-existent. God is the one who was and is to come. But the name Jehovah is often times in scripture compounded with another name. And these names identify God's covenant relationship with his people. God's covenant relationship with his people. I am the one who will do this for you, do this and this and this and this. You've heard of names like Jehovah Rapha or Rophe, and that is the Lord who heals you. There is Jehovah Nisi and Jehovah Shalom and Jehovah Tzidkenu. All these compound names identify who God is and what is his covenant relationship to his people. What will he do for his people? Our banner, our healer, our righteousness, our peace. Well, likewise, Jehovah Jireh or Jireh, Jehovah, Jireh, might be the pronunciation in Hebrew. The word Jireh or Jireh is provider. And actually the name literally mean the Lord sees. The Lord sees. But with that, because he sees and provides or has made provision, because he sees what you need. God sees what you need. And therefore, because he sees it, he has already taken care of making provision. Glory to God. Now, we see that name, Jehovah Jireh, in Genesis 22. And this is the chapter where God tested Abraham and said, take your son Isaac, whom you love, go to the region of Moriah and sacrifice him as a burnt offering on the mountain I will tell you. So early the next morning, verse 3, Abraham got up, saddled his donkey, took two of his servants and his son Isaac, and they went to the region of Moriah. Notice, early the next morning, Abraham did not hesitate to do what God had asked. Why? Because God had already made a blood covenant with him in chapter 15. The blood covenant was cut. The oath was sworn between him and God. So he knew he had a covenant relationship with God, and that God had made promises to him. And so he expected God to fulfill his promises and keep his part of the covenant relationship that he had made. Now, in Abraham's time, covenant was very, very significant and very highly honored. Highly honored, not lightly esteemed, but strongly esteemed, heavily esteemed. And so because God had made a covenant with him in chapter 15, he knew God had made covenant promises and oaths, promising to give him land and promising to give him a son. And not only to give him a son, but he said, look up at the stars and your seed will be as numerous as the stars, and your seed will come through Isaac. So he knew Isaac was the promise, and that the seed, the multitude of seed like the stars, would come through Isaac. God had already said that. So when God said, offer Isaac, then Abraham did not hesitate. As you read in Hebrews 11, Abraham had his heart set on the raising of the dead. He was believing for the raising of the dead. Hebrews 11 says that. So he said, okay, if God had already made an oath in blood that my seed will be reckoned through Isaac as numerous as the stars, now he asks me to sacrifice him. Well, then the only logical final conclusion is God is going to raise Isaac from the dead. And Hebrews 11 shows us that Abraham had his heart set on the resurrection of the dead. Now, actually, if you know the types and the shadows and the portrayal of this, this is actually Abraham is even believing God for Jesus' resurrection from the dead, because the seed that would come through Isaac to redeem man would be Jesus, to redeem mankind, and Jesus would be raised from the dead. Well, that's another sermon anyway. Is you go down in Genesis 22, and you see that Abraham built the altar, arranged the wood, and laid his son Isaac on the altar, reached out, took the knife to slay his son. And then in verse 11, the angel of the Lord called out to him, Abraham, Abraham, do not lay a hand on the boy. And then he said, do not do anything to him. Now I know you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. And verse 13, Genesis 22, 13, Abraham looked up, and there in a thicket, he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. Now, verse 14, this is where we see in the Hebrew text the name Jehovah Jireh. So Abraham called that place Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. And to this day, it is said, on the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. Now, the name actually means literally the Lord sees. But look at the word provision, provision. If you take that word in English, even in the English, you see the word vision, which means seeing, seeing. So provision, you see the word pro, P-R-O, prefix, I mean the prefix pro, and you see the word vision, which means seeing. Seeing. So pro, the prefix pro means before or ahead. It's like pre, P-R-E, and pro, P-R-O, they both mean ahead, in advance, beforehand. And vision means seeing. So provision means seeing beforehand, seeing ahead of time. The literal meaning is actually prevision. We would call it in today's English foresight, foresight, F-O-R-E-S-I-G-H-T, foresight. If a person has foresight, they are seeing ahead and they are doing something about it ahead of time. You have foresight when something is going to happen. Maybe you're going to have company come over for dinner. Let's say Thanksgiving. Now your foresight is making preparations ahead of time. You make out your grocery list. You start with the menu, and then to fulfill the menu, you make your grocery list and you go to the grocery store. You might have to clean house. You might have to get things ready in different ways. But your foresight to company coming over for Thanksgiving dinner is you are making preparations in advance, ahead of time, getting ready. That's what foresight is. Foresight is seeing what's coming before it comes and getting ready for it, or doing something properly that will need to be done for that you see ahead of time. And foresight then is a very good synonym for provision. It's seeing ahead, but because you see ahead, foresight is taking action to get ready. Provision is prevision, seeing ahead, and not just seeing it, but then taking steps and action to get ready for what you see coming. Getting ready for what you see coming. So provision is getting ready for what you see coming. You can also say it's arranging things in advance. Measures taken beforehand or ahead of time. It is preparations, making previous prior arrangements for supply of a need you see coming. And God's provision is the action of God, God's actions, providing in advance for his people, for his people. So God preparing in advance, taking measures and steps ahead of time to make arrangements and preparations for the supply of then all the needs of his people before they come, before the need arises. And I love reading in conjunction with this scriptures in the King James, particularly uses the language before the foundation of the world or from the foundation of the world. I love those promises, from the foundation of the world or before the foundation of the world. And we see God has made provision from the foundation of the world. That was from or before the foundation, either way it's spoken. That is God taking measures before there was even an earth. Before there was an earth, before there was mankind, before mankind was created, God made provisions for all our needs. Matthew 25:34 says, regarding the promises of God, then the king will say to his to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Come, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. So God prepared his kingdom for you from the foundation of the world. In Ephesians 1:4, it says, he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Notice this was all part of his plan before the foundation of the world, before there ever was a world. In his heart, he had a plan, and we were chosen in him before the foundation of the world. Hebrews 4:3, the works were finished from the foundation of the world. His works were finished from the foundation of the world. His works were finished. Well, we know he worked for 6 days, and on the seventh day he rested. Why did he rest? Because he was tired? No, because he was finished. He was finished with everything. And we see all of his works were finished from the foundation of the world. And 1 Peter 1:19-20, we were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish or spot, who was foreordained before the foundation of the world. And Revelation 13:8, the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. From the foundation of the world, you were chosen in him. The lamb was slain. We were redeemed. And he had preparation for you for everything you would ever need before the foundation of the world. Well, we'll pick this up again tomorrow. Remember, God loves you. You're blessed and highly favored by the Lord.